Happy Sabbath. Welcome to Fellowship of the Word. It is January 7th, 2023. And for call to worship this morning, we're going to start with, "Where could I go but to the Lord?"
Leaving me alone in this old sinful world.
Thank you. Blessed is he who has regard for the weak. The Lord delivers him in times of trouble. The Lord will protect him and preserve his life. He will bless him in the land and not surrender him to the desire of his foes. The Lord will sustain him on his sickbed and restore him from his bed of illness. I said, "The Lord, O Lord, have mercy on me. Heal me, for I have sinned against you. My enemies say of me in malice, 'When will he die and his name perish?' Whenever one comes to see me, he speaks falsely, while his heart gathers slander. When he goes out and spreads it abroad, all my enemies whisper together against me. They imagine the worst for me, saying, 'A vile disease has beset him. He will never get up from the place where he lies.' Even my close friends whom I have trusted, he who shares my bread, he has lifted up heel against me. But you, O Lord, have mercy on me. Raise me up, that I may repay them. I know that you are pleased with me, for my enemy does not triumph over me in my integrity. You uphold me and set me in your presence forever. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen.
I love you, God, for your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held by your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, and I will sing of the goodness of Yah. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of Yah. Your voice, you have led me through the fire and darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of Yah. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of Yah. Yes, your goodness is running now. It's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after me. and faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of Yah. I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
Shabbat Shalom. Welcome to what I consider is probably one of the most important interactive studies we've done. It's been about 15 years since we did this, and it seems to be something that's been pretty hard and heavy on Monty Bernard's hearts for quite a long time. It's probably heavier on his because he's seen some more things than I have. I'm just here to kind of do an opening and share a few scriptures before we get started. And these scriptures are why I am here, period. Okay, 1 Thessalonians 5 and 21, you can either look it up. I'll give you time to look it up. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 21 says, "Prove all things and hold fast that which is good." So when I was 19 years old, it's been 32 years, when I came into, I've heard of the Sabbath all my life because my grandfather was a follower way before I was even part of this life, okay? But when I became 19, God had called me, opened my eyes up, and I proved all things. I wanted to prove. And I still have that attitude today. If you tell me something, I just don't automatically jump on your bandwagon. I'm going to go home and look for myself, and I'm going to find out what the Lord leads me to. So that's what I'm asking everyone to do today is open your ears, open your eyes, open your heart. And I'm not asking to change any view you have. It's what we're asking is that you study with us. If you have a point to make, make your point. Whether it's in contention or not, we're going to do this in love. We're going to do this in order. You don't have to agree with everything, but we're going to go through the Word of God as much as best we can over the next few weeks. I don't care how long this takes, in my opinion, okay? Because this is a very, very important study, in my view, okay? We're one of the only couple of churches that I know of that allows women to even get up here and to do what some of you ladies here have been able to do, is actually give scripture reading, to sing. We know some churches for a lady to get up here and do a scripture reading, some dude needs to be standing over here by her, some guy in authority. So those are the type of things that we may want to address, may not. Turn to Proverbs chapter 25. And Bernard's mentioned this scripture several times over the past few months. Proverbs 25, verse 2 says, "It is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but it is the honor of kings to search out a matter." It is honorable for us to search out anything we think we're going to use as doctrines, teachings, beliefs, or whatever. Everything. So hopefully here the next few weeks, I'm going to start hitting some Passover, some Days of Unleavened sermons before we get there to kind of open up ours. In my opinion, the Days of Unleavened Bread is reviewing some of the things you think you might believe. That is the leavening that I've been trying to remove out of my life over the past 10 years at least. Because I came out of a culture of a church to where, women couldn't put on makeup. And then women could put on makeup. And then women, they went back, they couldn't put on makeup. Then they went back, they could put on makeup. It was ridiculous theology that was going on within my church culture that I love very dearly. Trust me, okay? Proverbs chapter 18. And this is one that's a very serious matter within my heart, okay? Proverbs 18 and verse 13 says he, man, I can't even, I can't even see what my word, but I said I can see. "He that answereth a matter before he hears it, it is a folly and a shame unto him." So what this scripture says, you know, we have some bad cases here and I've been getting part of this. If someone's speaking to you and you cut them off, it is a folly and a shame to you. Until you hear that matter, then you think about that matter before you open your mouth. That's the way this thing works. So
There was times that years and years ago when we got into the study, we had a gentleman here who was so against women even breathing in our building, okay, that's kind of the way we felt, that he berated Bernard, Danny, myself, several other guys for 3 years. Email, okay? So finally, I got this email, and it took me maybe 3 to 6 months to decide to respond, okay? And I do have a study. It was done by a lady that we all love who's passed now. Her name is Donna Hamlet. We had that study available. I sent it to Scott and Andrea this week. They read it, and I was looking back through it. It was very, very, very well put together. Even though there's some things now she was allowed today, she could probably learn some more. But it was through her own personal example. She goes to Jerusalem and goes to put her prayer in the wall and realizes that there is a man's section and a women's section. And she was in the men's section and didn't realize it. And almost caused a riot in Jerusalem. She thought they were going to finally wind up attacking her. Okay, so, and that made her open, what is going on here? So she wrote this 40-something pages, okay? Very well done. And I have that. Bernard has that. If anyone would like a copy, we could email that to you, and I'll just let me know. It's very well done.
Just put links on the website.
Sometimes. We could do that. It's very well done. We have kind of haven't looked at it in years, and I really enjoyed going back through and seeing, you know, Miss Donna and seeing what she said. But with that said, that remember order, microphones, Danny said it. If you speak out without a microphone, you're not going to be heard. Raise your hand. No over-talking. This is about love. It's about whoever believes better than what someone else has believed. This is about what we're going to do as a fellowship, okay? This is the final decision of what we may be able to do some things down the road. So if you have contention, this is the time, in my opinion, it's time to get it out, okay? Or leave the matter closed. So, and I'll just say that, and you guys can take that, whatever. But I'm going to turn it over to Bernard, and I'll do the microphones running around, and Bernard can take it from here.
I do have a couple things I wanted to one of the big things for me was with this issue is that I personally witnessed spirits getting crushed over the years. I mean, I've been in the Church of God culture for, I don't know, since the early, mid-90s, we'll say. My first feast was like 96 or something, I think. So since then, I've witnessed spirits getting crushed. And we know there's scriptures that say, don't crush people's spirits, you know. So those are, that's something that has been put on my heart throughout those years of seeing spirits crushed and then questioning, well, wait a minute, what's going on here, you know. And as he said, I don't think it was 16 years ago, but whatever. It was like, I thought it was, she did that, but the study that we did with the two groups, I thought was in 2010 or so, so a few years after. But anyway, it's been a while, regardless, it's been over a decade now, how you cut it, slice it, since we've gone really through this as a group. And we did it actually then with two groups, our group and another group that was meeting with us or after us most of the time. And anyway, So I just want to tell you the reason why it really has been put on my heart that it's something that is very important. I think it's probably one of, if not the most important issue that I think folks in general, whether it's Sabbatarian or mainstream, you know, if spirits are getting crushed, if people are told they're not allowed to use their spiritual gifts and stuff, they better have a good reason for it. And I feel they need to, well, I'll go ahead and say that I have a couple questions that I would put forth as the challenge. Because we have a lot of, if we have spirits getting crushed, and we know at the end times, we need to come together. Everybody needs to be using their spiritual gifts. If you don't know what your spiritual gift is, we should pray for that, right? We should help one another, encourage one another to find that spiritual gift, use that spiritual gift. I mean, God put on my heart a long time ago when I asked him, what do we want me to do? What do you want me to do? And the only thing that came back, literally, was music. That was it. You know, and it was at a time, a low point in my life when after losing my mom and kind of realizing that I'd lost my dad years before and everyone went to his funeral and everything, that I needed to make some changes in my life for sure. But, you know, you start questioning things and whatnot. But, you know, I was not doing a whole lot of music for a while. And I had kind of set that gift on the back burner for a while. So, again, when you really get an idea from God or God puts it on your heart what your spiritual gift is, if you don't know what it is, not that I didn't know I had a, you know, musical gift, but that was the focus that God wanted me to do, and a lot of doors have opened since. Thank you, Lord. Oh, so healing. Okay, so in my view, here's a couple things. I usually try to cut to the chase with a lot of things, you know. So here are the things. Here's my challenge to the status quo, and it's expressed in just a few questions, really. So question one, where in God's law, okay, you know, what do we do? What do we try to figure out? What's sin? What's not sin, right? What's good to do? What's not to do? So where in God's law, in Torah, is there found a prohibition over women speaking, teaching, preaching? What do we want to call that word? I mean, it's really all the same to me. Prophesying, teaching, speaking, you know, during Sabbath convocations or otherwise. So where is there a law in God's law against allowing women from doing so? And the answer that I found is, thus far, I've not found one, and no one else has either, or else we would have certainly heard of it by now, because this issue's been around for a long time. I've never seen anyone bring forth anything from Torah for this matter in particular. All right, question two, where does the Bible give authority for Paul or anyone to add to or subtract from God's commandments and statutes? So where does it say that Paul can do so? The answer that I understand is not even God adds to or subtracts from his law. Therefore, certainly Paul was not given such authority to do so. Question three, considering that scriptures plainly state God will pour out his spirit upon all flesh so that both men and women will prophesy in the last days as exemplified since Christ's fleshly manifestation. In other words, when he was in the physical form, when Christ was there, he spoke in at least a couple different places about how he considered that the last days already. Okay, that's, and we can look at the scriptures, of course, but so this whole bit about pouring out the Holy Spirit upon all flesh in those last days is talked about in Joel 2:28 and Acts chapter 2 verses 17 through 18, for example. Okay, so by whose authority may we justly prohibit that which God has ordained? In other words, by whose authority can someone say, no, don't do these things, even though it's already been ordained by God that it's going to happen, right? So my answer there, as far as I can understand it so far, is no one can justly mandate such prohibitions, for we are admonished to not quench other spirits, right? You can believe whatever you want to believe about all sorts of stuff, but we're not supposed to quench other people's spirits. Okay, so question four, and this is the last question and answer that I have here, that our great commission is to preach the gospel to the world, Acts 1:8, Matthew 28:18-20, does this task not apply to women, seeing how doing so involves teaching? So my answer there, as far as I can understand it, is I find no scriptures that prohibits women from taking part in the great commission. Rather, that all those in Christ are supposed to do so. Now, one thing that's interesting about that is, and it's in that original study, we've gone over a lot of this stuff in the original study that we did multiple years ago, whenever it was. One of the things I found kind of amusing is that Mary, the first person to preach the gospel of the risen Christ was Mary. She's the first one. So it was a woman. It's funny how God designed that to happen, urged, nudged, however that works, you know, that to happen. So it's kind of interesting to me. But anyway, to me, those are the matters at the core of the issue, the core of the issue. Torah, you know, how do we deal with any issue? Whether to keep Sabbath or not, whether to keep the feast or not, how to keep Passover, why to keep Passover, any of these things. You know, name it an issue about what we do or how we work in the church and everything that we aren't supposed to go back to Torah to find out, well, what does it say in Torah? What does it actually say about these matters? And this is the only one, well, not the only one, actually. There are a few other ones, actually. It's kind of interesting. But we can get to that as we go, because I want to get everything opened. Let's open up the floor first, because we know that there's these scriptures that we're going to go through for Paul. But let's open up.
I do have one comment, is that I don't want to be guilty when I stand before my king and say, you know, Father, we had these issues going on, you know, at church, you know, why didn't you send us a messenger? And this might sound crazy or ridiculous to you, but what if his answer is, I did send you a messenger, but she was wearing a dress? Okay? We have females and women who have a gift that are not being able to use their gift because they're gender difference, okay? We believe that Paul, there is some misconceptions in what Paul was actually speaking about. And it's only Paul. What does the 11 apostles ever say about it? Nothing. Okay? It's just the writings of Paul. So we take Paul so literal that, you know, we had a guy that called us demons. Just because a lady took, what, say, male sitting here, and male, would you write this down? Because we had a person do that, called us a church of demons. Okay? So we're trying to get past this issue of what we can allow our ladies to do. And if we're sent a prophet that is a lady, guys, we need to get off our rockers, I'm telling you. Because the Word of God that I read talks about female prophets, talks about female deacons, talks about females doing a lot more work than we ever thought about doing. But because we come from a culture that taught us one thing and we just hung on to it. I was there. But I'm no longer, because I ask questions to God and I prove all things to my mind and let God be the answer. So, who's first?
I saw one arm.
You got Doris first?
And then Wayne, I think, after that.
Well, I've fluctuated back and forth on this issue, and I've talked to a couple people here in the church about it. Mm-hmm. And I've known people over the years that go to a church where the woman is a pastor. Mm-hmm. And I've had a problem with that. I don't think women should be pastors. And I have an image sometime of women getting up there and running the church, and I'm all against that. Mm-hmm. But I did do some studying yesterday on the computer. And it's really interesting. Deborah was a judge. And Elizabeth and Mary confirmed with their mouths the promise of the Messiah and the word of the Lord from the angel. Mary herself sang songs that became scripture. And that's in Luke, 1 Luke 46 through 55. So there's example after example of where women have very prominent speaking in the Bible, in the Old Testament. Many women actually spoke and wrote words that became scripture, such as Miriam, and of course Deborah and Hannah, and these are all listed. And so this is real eye-opener to me. And moving specifically to the Gospels of the New Testament, women are seen in the most prominent roles, four women in particular. Well, no, this is actually in the Old Testament. I'm sorry. Rahab, Ruth, Bathsheba, and Mary. These are all singled out in the genealogy of Jesus. So I've just got all this here that's listed, and it's really quite interesting. You know, it's kind of opened my eyes a little bit.
First of all, you get a gold star because you did some homework. real quick, on the what is it? Rahab, was it? Isn't it interesting, because I heard an interview this week with someone that wrote a book about some of this stuff, and she pointed out how it's kind of interesting how so many people refer to her as the harlot instead of the savior of the 12 spies. So it's just interesting how over time, you know, she might have repented of being, do we know exactly what happened? I don't know the whole story and the history followed through, but my point is that it seems like sometimes women are slighted in ways that they don't necessarily need to be. David did evil things too. Abraham did evil. You know, everybody's done evil. So why do we bring up David or Abraham or these people and say whatever the sin was associated with them? We don't do that, but we do that with Rahab for some reason. Anyway, I think Wayne was next over here. And then there was a hand over here. This, okay. Thanks for helping.
It's magic.
Just one time.
Yeah, there we go. Okay. Couple things. First, thank you for your spirit of music. I love how you share it with your spiritual gifts. So thank you very much. Another quick question about the email you sent out. I didn't get it. Was it about the four questions you had?
No. It was just about what we were going to do, which is basically that this has been an issue for a long time, a very contentious one in the churches of God. I don't know how far it reaches. I know that different groups, Sabbatarian and mainstream, have different viewpoints on it.
Okay.
You know, I'm sure it's very varied, and I'm sure within one body, not everyone agrees in that same body, because, hey, we all agree on every point of doctrine here, right? And we're 30 people or so. You know what I'm saying?
You think I can get that email?
Well, we got to check. I don't know. I thought you were on my list there. So
I am. You asked me before, so
all right,
you must have missed me.
Okay, we'll figure it out.
And then lastly, I came from a congregation, and I was in a role as deacon for a while, and women weren't allowed to do that. And I always thought, what a shame, because I thought they had a lot more gifts in that area of caring for the congregation than the men did. So So I'm anxious to hear more about this. Thank you for doing this.
You're welcome. Over
here. It's on. Hi. So I was just going to say, with a little bit of background, I was born into this faith. And of course, when you're growing up, you decide for yourself and all that kind of stuff. But I've been coming to this church since I was 15, 16. So even though I haven't seen all of you as much, it's just because there's also another congregation we check out and we're traveling a lot. But so I've been coming here since I was 16. I'm 27. So about 11 years. And what I find interesting is CFN, before it was CFN, was CEM, Christian Educational Ministries. It was started by Ron Dart. And I remember when I was about 14 or 15, they had something called Youth Day at the Feast of Tabernacles down in Florida. And they said, we need someone. Skip Martin was in charge of it and said, we need someone. We want to have someone in charge of music. We want to have someone in charge of getting people, young people, to do scripture readings, and someone in charge of plays and stuff like that, so it have all the youth involved. He could not find any young man to do it. So who stepped up? I stepped up for music. Caitlin Parent stepped up for finding people to do messages. Jillie Edwards organized all the plays and stuff like that. And we single-handedly, with Skip Martin, put on Youth Day. And then a few years ago, we went to the feast in Kentucky. Brianne Deering and I taught the children's classes. And I was in charge of Youth Day again. And I was teaching the kids' classes. And I could not get any of the kids, none of the little boys in the class wanted to read scripture readings for Youth Day. All the little girls wanted to. And so I said, okay, I'm going to go talk to your parents and make sure that they're okay with it so they can help you practice. All the little girls' parents, except for one, said they were not allowed to read scripture readings for Youth Day. And none of the boys would step up. And so then the problem comes, and this sounds harsh, but if you don't want women to speak at all, to even read scripture readings, then you need to make your little boys step up. And I know we don't have that problem here, but it is very hard when growing up as a girl in church, you want to be involved, and your counterpart does not, and so therefore you have no one doing it. That's very hard when you have the desire to speak and to read scripture readings and stuff like that, or to sing. And that same Feast of Tabernacles, I got in trouble because I was announcing the next song, and I was told I was not allowed to do that, and I cried. I went outside and was bawling. That's not fair. And Skip Martin cussed someone out, which is really funny.
Now, be careful. Don't tell on Skip too much now. He gets in enough trouble.
But he was so upset, too.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And that's just not fair.
We actually had a 2 or 3 hour conversation after that with one other elder that was willing to talk about it. And one of the things he said, I'm not going to mention any names. From here, we only mention Skip Martin. We don't mention any other names, but Skip Martin. Skip's Skip. We had a long conversation after that because the elder was saying that, you know, a lot of these other elders just don't want to touch this issue with a 10-foot pole because it's a very, difficult issue for a lot of people. And obviously, spirits are crushed. And that was one of the ones, one of my examples is you and Rian that one time. It's very, very moving. One thing I wanted to mention, you brought up CFN, and we were just there. My wife and I were just there at the winter family weekend up in Lexington, Kentucky. It happens over Christmas weekend or thereabouts every year. I've been there for 19. Mike Deering reminded me, I was there for 19 years, minus the time I was in Texas during COVID year. I've been there for 19 years going to the winter weekend. Anyway, the reason why I brought it up, one of the things that Jim O'Brien's been, and Guy Swenson and Bill Jacobs and these guys have been so great at over the years. You said it a long time ago, 10 years maybe ago, 7 or something. Danny asked you, why do you like that group? And you said something to the effect of, because they involve us as young people. They want to involve us. Well, it was brought up at the winter weekend, ideas, how to make church better, all these types of things and whatnot. The big thing comes up, youth are leaving the church. Why are they leaving the church? Two big reasons came up that Jim was talking about. One of the reasons is feeling purpose, like they have a purpose to be included and that sort of thing. The other one was they really were repelled by hypocrisy. Now, I got to say, that's one that, actually, quite frankly, me as a little child, those two issues are, like, really, really dear to me, too. I don't know what it is. I have a hard time sometimes feeling useful, which seems weird because I do music and I do other stuff, but sometimes I just get that problem. But the other thing is hypocrisy really, really burns me, especially because it's this pious, when it gets into the piousness of righteousness, I'm more righteous because I do this or that. It's like, wait a minute, Christ is the righteous one. And I know we have some interesting talks about righteousness, but I believe when it talks about a human being righteous, like this person was righteous or whatever, that's on a human scale. We got a different scale. We're talking about God as far as righteousness goes. In my opinion, that's the way I see it. But so what was brought out was, well, one of the things, how do we, CFM was what we were talking about this. How do we encourage the youth to be more involved in this sort of thing? Well, one of the things that came up was, hey, get them to come up and do scripture reading. Get them to come up and lead the congregation in prayer. Get them to come up and sing or play a song if they're learning songs and stuff like that. You know, oh yeah. And then the person who was speaking was like, oh, wait, but then they're going to grow up, and then you got to tell the girls at some point, whatever age of adulthood you presume that to be, oh, you can't do this anymore. Does that make any sense? Everybody, nobody said anything. I was going to raise my hand, but I decided, you know what, I'm not going to say anything, because everybody was thinking, I'm sure, the same thing. That seems pretty ridiculous, doesn't it? To tell little boys and girls that they can be included in all these things, but then once women reach a certain age, which does it say anywhere in the Bible what the age of adulthood really is? I've heard some concepts of course, traditionally 13-ish, right? That's when all these different things happen physiologically, spiritually, in various cultures, not just the Hebrew culture, but like a Catholic. There's confirmation in Catholics. There's bar mitzvahs and things like that for in Judaism. I don't know what happens in Protestantism. They might throw that a miss. I don't know. But, you know, all these things happen. And I've also heard recently another thing, that the age 20, there's something about atonement.
That's when you are accountable for your salvation.
Yeah. So the age of innocence, there's some, and I haven't really studied this through, but I've just seen a couple scriptures that talk about the age of innocence being maybe closer to 20, which is an interesting thing. I don't know. I'd say it's a little lower myself, but I don't know. Maybe it's a range. Maybe it's 13 to 20, depending on the person. I don't know. But the point is that think about the logic behind the concept of inviting all the kids, no matter what gender, to be involved in church services, and then at some point between, let's say, 13 and something, 18 or 20, you say, oh, you can't do this anymore because you're a girl. Does that make any sense? Does that sound like logical,
no,
anything from God? And then we'll see if the scriptures bear this out over time, of course. Okay.
All right, y'all bear with me. It's going to take a few seconds. I remember what Chloe's talking about, and I watched it crush her and Rianne both. And it was actually Jamie, our oldest son, he was still coming to the feast at that time, had to actually walk out on stage with Rianne. I think it was at the fun show or something to even introduce stuff, because they would not let her go up there without a male standing there. So with this, I'm going to say, when Christ was crucified and he had risen, who did he reveal himself to?
Mary.
Two women. He told them to go spread the good news. He had risen. Even his own disciples who had walked with him in his ministry didn't recognize him. But the two women did. But I'm also going to say this. It's just in my opinion, not only the men that have suppressed the women in the church, it's the elder women. Because I've experienced it myself, you know. And I'm assuming it's because they've been ingrained, indoctrinated, whatever word you want to use, that being told, you know, woman cannot, you know, and it kind of, what the man tell them, it spills off onto the younger women, you know. And I'm ashamed to say it. I've witnessed a lot of the elder women in the church gossip, talk about each other, put each other down, and I'm thinking, what is your problem? We are supposed to be lifting each other up. If I come and talk to someone about something, a particular situation or a person, I'm trying to figure out how to deal with it, how to do it, because Lord knows if I do it my way, it's going to go south. So, but we need to be lifting each other up, encouraging each other, but I'm also going to say this. Not every woman, not every man is called to be a speaker. And that goes for the man too. If you've been attending feasts long enough or whatever, you know, a woman can't opinionate it, but you're like, why's he even up there? Where's he going with this? What's he doing? Or he's here, there, and yonder, and everywhere, and it just confused you even more. You know, so the only thing I can suggest is people pray. I'm still praying for mine. I don't know what mine are, my spiritual gifts. I ask God every day to show me because I just ain't getting it. I'm one of them hard-headed people. I'm like Jim, but I'm just kidding. I'm picking on him. But it's difficult. You know, and that's what I'm trying to say is just because women get a free reign or whatever doesn't mean because you want to do whatever don't mean it's your gift that God's given you. I'm saying think about it. Pray about it. You know, it might be, God help me, I tell her all the time, but Bonnie makes me cry. I have to go hide when she sings. It's like, it moves my spirit. That's your ministry, and I've told you that, you know, but you got to really think about this because some things are opinions that we put out there. And I know I learn different. I learn a whole lot different, and some things are confusion for me. And it's just like when one person says Bernard can get up there and say something, then Roger can get up there and say something that's totally different than what Bernard said. And then Danny can go up there and say something that's totally different. And I'm like, well, which one is right? You know? And if you're not on the same page to a degree in what you're thinking, what you're believing, whatever it is, I mean, it was at times confusing for people because I know there's been a few come to me like, well, this was confusing. And I don't know how to explain it to them. The only thing I can say is you need to address Roger, Bernard, or Danny. Because, heck, I'm confused myself, but, you know, just be mindful of what we're saying and what we're doing, and don't try to crush each other's spirit, and I'm tripping on my words because I'm getting anxious, you know, don't be rude to someone if they don't understand something in this Bible study or in this one or whatever, because they might not get it. It might be, oh, God, how can you be coming here 20-something years and not know, you know, because or not me, but they've addressed the issue on women speaking before. It's maybe your ears wasn't open. Maybe God didn't open your ears for a reason. Or for me, I still don't agree with it all the way. I'm still learning, but it's because it's been pushed in me. No, 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 no. And Bernard and Roger was here. There was a guy that kept coming at the time. He looked me dead in the face. I said, because I get up there and do prayer from the prayer request and whatever. My question to him was, so you think I'm sinning by praying up there just behind that piece of wood? And he said, yes, you are.
So, and that was 2 years ago or so, and she's been kind of timid about doing so ever since, as you know.
Yep.
She's been asking Jim or somebody else. Sometimes when she feels better, she's back here. And one time, speaking of CEM real quick, a long time ago, one of my buddies back then that isn't really with the church anymore, I guess, but at the time, he was, when he first went to the CEM feast, he was upset. You ready? He was upset. And later he laughed about it. But he was upset because there was a female usher. So she wasn't even up behind the piece of wood. So that's how far these things go. Just saying, okay, who's next?
All right. So I can provide some context in the Protestant church.
There you go. Okay.
I've been, you know, prior to coming here a year ago, been Protestant churches for like 36 years. And I've definitely seen the same kind of thing there as well, where there's division either among elders or, you know, different views about how women's role should be. And we've seen, unfortunately, a section of the church leave because of that issue. And so there was, not to go into details, but there was a woman who was leading the children's ministry. And you know, any time that there were decisions that had to be made, it was like, there's always like second guessing and that sort of thing. And I got to the point where she was like, I can't do this because I feel like I'm being stifled, you know, kind of thing. And, you know, something happened and basically she left, and then a bunch of other people left as well. So that was, you know, that kind of stuck out, like, you know, to me where, you know, and they tried to do, Bible studies to try to get on the same page, and it was difficult. But so yes, my point there is, I think this is a major issue everywhere. It's not just Churches of God or Sabbatarian churches. I wanted to read something that when you to illustrate a point that we need to read things in context and understand the cultural, like we talk about Paul, right? So I'm going to read something out of context, and then I want to read it in context, if that's all right.
Yeah.
All right. So 1 Corinthians chapter 11, that should be pretty obvious, I guess, that we go there. If we look at verse 8, for man was made not from woman, but woman from man. Neither was man created for woman, but woman for man. That is why a wife ought to have a symbol of authority on her head. So, like, if you just read that out of context, it's like, wow, like, what is this talking about? And that people could use that one direction or another, right? So if we read, starting at verse 1, we'll start at verse 2, that's the head covering thing. So it says, verse 2, now I commend you because you remember me in everything and maintain the traditions, even as I delivered them to you. But I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of a wife is her husband, and the head of Christ is God. Every man who prays or prophesies with his head covered dishonors his head, but every wife who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head, since it is the same as if her head were shaven. For if a wife will not cover her head, then she should cut her hair short. But since it is disgraceful for a wife to cut her hair or shave her head, let her cover her head. For a man ought to not cover his head, since he is the image and the glory of God, but a woman is the glory of man. For man was not made from woman, but woman from man. Neither was man created for woman, but woman for man. That is why a wife ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. Nevertheless, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man, nor man of woman. For as woman was made from man, now man is born of woman, and all things are from God. Judge for yourselves, is it proper for a wife to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not nature itself teach you that a man wears long hair is a disgrace for him, but if a woman has long hair, it is her glory, for hair is given to her for a covering. If anyone is inclined to be contentious, we have no such practice, nor do the churches of God. So if you look at the culture back there, and of course none of us have lived in that time, so, you know, if you do historical studies, you know, take what you will from it, but Paul was writing specifically to address some disorder or chaos that happened in the church. And, you know, just generally men and women were kind of, you know, they're speaking out of turn and, you know, prophesying. And at the time there were Gentiles and Jews both in the church. And, you know, the Jews had an image in their head of what a prophet should look like and all that kind of cultural context. And it was causing division at that time, right? And so also women having uncovered long hair could invoke, you know, like lust and that sort of thing at that time. It's just the whole culture was different than it is today. So I think, you know, if you kind of look into that, it gives it a different context of, well, it's not saying that women should not, you know, speak up or pray or that sort of thing. It's more, we should all do it in respect of each other. And, you know, it's different today, I feel like, than it is then. That's my personal interpretation of it. And it even says, you know, in verse, 11, we're not independent of each other. You know, man is born of woman too. So it's like a, you know, it's an interdependent kind of thing. And you know, everyone and everything comes from God. So, you know, I think that we all have different roles to play given, like, I think it was Darla that said, given skills, like just because you are a man or a woman, it doesn't mean you should or shouldn't, you know, say, so, you know, just, it's like, we all need to pray and look to God and, you know, consider that. So that's all I have.
Real quick, I'm glad you brought 1 Corinthians 11 up. Of course, we all know that chapter has been used for a myriad of arguments. Hair lengths, one of them. I've shared this before. I've been told in the past that not only is it a sin for a man to have long hair, What about Samson? John the Baptist, probably. What about Christ? Probably. But anyway, but it's a sin or a shame. It depends on who you were talking to in this case. A sin for a woman to have short hair. That's what some people get out of that whole section, by the way. You know, and the funny thing is, I've always said there is, isn't it funny that when he says, look at nature, does it nature not show us about hair lengths or whatever this is? Well, actually, if we look at nature, literally, it's the male of things like the lions and birds and whatnot that have the greater plumage. The hair is longer, more beautiful and attractive to attract a woman, right? That sort of thing. So it's funny how Paul does, I think, a tongue-in-cheek kind of thing. That, and at the end, it's like we shouldn't be contentious over these matters. This cultural thing. Some people say, well, you have to do it this way. And other people say, well, why? The other thing about the culture there is that all the women coming in from the Greek or pagan secular culture, one thing that we should all know about that goes back further than that, even in ancient Israel, was temple prostitutes with pagan cultures, right? When they were praying, doing whatever they do to their, you know, with their gods, there were temple prostitutes involved. And from what I've read, and I haven't studied this through, but one of the in the culture of that time, that one of the things they would do is have their hair really long braided. There's a section in that Paul talks about not having braided hair. Are we supposed to apply that to God's law suddenly? That women, stop braiding your hair, we got to watch out for that. No, it's a cultural situation. But here's the extra interesting thing about 1 Corinthians 11 to me, is that, remember, 1 Corinthians 14, 34, and 35, which is only three chapters later, that's held in this contentious saying, well, women can't speak in church. We're talking about just a few chapters earlier when it says in verse 4, every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. But every woman who prays or prophesies, oh, wait a minute, it's saying a woman prays or prophesies. So now, why would Paul, if he intended three chapters later to say women can't prophesy, can't preach, can't talk in church and all this stuff, why would he say this here? That wouldn't make any sense. There wouldn't be anything governing the way in which a woman prophesies or prays or whatever in church if they weren't allowed to begin with, if it wasn't in Torah to begin with. So, you know, what do you deal with this 1 Corinthians 14 and 34 and 35? How do you deal with that? Well, it's interesting because I didn't really look at this in a long time, I think. Maybe I never heard about it before. The original word translated as speak there, which it says, let me just read the chapter, or read the verse real quick, the two verses, so we can read them real quickly here. Let your women keep silent in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but they are to be submissive, as the law also says. And if they want to learn something, let them ask their own husbands at home, for it is shameful for women to speak in church. That original word translated as speak is leleo, probably not pronouncing that right, but close enough for me, which can simply mean utter a voice, speak, right? But can also apparently mean to chatter in classical Greek, chatter. You ever hear that chatty Cathy, right? That's a little term. Well, seeing how the entire chapter 14 addresses order during church services, it appears the translation might be more accurate to understand certain women in the Corinthian church might have been overly chatty, which would certainly serve to diminish order during the time of worship and prayer and edification. All right, there's other reasons why that particular verses are in question. I have a link right now, I believe, on the stream. We're going to have supporting or associated documents that I'm going to connect to our studies here. One of them challenges whether those scriptures were supposed to be in the Bible to begin with, which is an interesting study in and of itself. So it's worth looking at regardless, okay? See, we're supposed to look at everything to find out what's true. Okay.
Danny, Chloe, Bonnie.
Okay.
Am I on?
Doesn't sound like it.
I'm muted.
You got to press that button.
Yeah. I wanted us to get more into the Bible with this study than we started. But what we did was good, but now we went into the Bible, so that's real good. And I was going to bring and read that the scripture in 1 Corinthians 14 about that. That is going to be, that's the scripture that people use all the time to prove their point. And so it's to me, this has to be studied strictly and in depth to get
to get to where we want to be on this subject. As far as I'm concerned, you know, just in reading the whole Bible and staying in God's Word for many, many, many years, I don't need an explanation to know that God is not against women and that they are just as valuable as men are. And but we have different places to fulfill. The leadership should come from a man. But I just cannot imagine even Fellowship of the Word without what the ladies contribute. I think it would be like we would be dull, ho-hum.
We wouldn't get anything to eat.
You know, it would just, it'd be sad. I think it would be sad. I think that our study, we need to stay on subject and stay in the scriptures and get to the bottom of it. And like Roger said, stay with it till we get to the bottom of it.
Next.
Who's next?
Chloe. And then Bonnie.
You bet the
Bonnie. Hey. Okay. I was just going to, there's a few things I was going to say, but so that we do not go all off, I will consolidate it. I was just going to say, Paul, I think every person in the Bible meant to be in the Bible. I don't have any ill intentions toward Paul. I will say, every single time I talk to anyone about the Feast of Tabernacles, any of the holy days, women speaking in church, they always use Paul to rebuttal against that. So we have to understand that when people use the scriptures of Paul, letters to the Corinthians, to respond to women, they will also use the exact same book or whatever to respond to why they don't have to keep the food laws, why they don't have to keep the holy days, and I'm just saying, like Bernard said earlier, who gave the authority to change God's law? God does not even change God's law. So we have to understand that the same book is coming up to counter everything that we're doing here. Not just women speaking in church, but everything. Doesn't mean that Paul's like, oh, I'm going to screw all these people over. That's not the point. The point is that we have to understand that the same thing has been taken out of context in every aspect of what we're doing here, and not just women speaking in church. So to be like, that's all incorrect, except when it comes to women speaking in church. So no, you're misunderstanding everything, because we are supposed to be keeping the Sabbath and the holy days. We are supposed to be keeping the holy days. We are supposed to be keeping the food laws. Paul didn't mean it like that. Except for when it comes to women, in which we take him 100% exceptionally 100% literate. Like, no. You know, either he's not taken literally or he is. I just wanted to point out that words of Paul have been used against everything that we're doing here today, and not just women, and there needs to be some consistency in that as well.
Amen to that. The other thing that's interesting to me is that people will use Paul, or I don't know if this is the right way to say this, they will allow Paul's words to take them off track of Christ, and they will go down this path presuming Paul is some antichrist figure. I do not believe that at all. No one in the leadership of this church believes that at all. It is nonsense to us. We don't believe that. Okay. But I will say that my personal belief is, you know, when God says, I will send a strong delusion to the itching ears and that sort of thing, how do we know he's not using Paul's words to do that? In other words, it might be by design that God is using Paul's, and we have a warning. We have a warning about be careful about Paul's writings, right? We all know that. If we don't, see, we're not going through every single scripture because most of us here have read these scriptures. So we're going to like mention them as we go and then see where we need to focus in, I think, you know, on certain, obviously we're focusing on certain scriptures. But does anyone not know about that scripture?
Peter, right?
Right? It's Peter. Okay. We want to turn there then. Can someone find it quickly? Because I don't have it. It's what book though? I can't remember. Twist, look up Twist as a search. I think Twist to their own understanding. Paul, who is difficult to understand. Those are some key search words.
Hard
to understand. We should read that. If you guys haven't read this, this is key.
Absolutely.
In my opinion, to understanding, you got to be very careful with Paul's words, because the way I look at it is this. Satan has used Paul's words to pull people into legalism on one hand, and I guess, I hate to use the word liberalism, it's more of anything goes on the other hand. In other words, you know, or you know, the law is done away with, these types of things, as Coley was talking about. So Paul's been used, his words have been used to go one way or the other. And so it's important that we understand this. Who wants to read it? Give her a mic, somebody.
What is it?
2 Peter 3:16.
Yeah, I'm going to go back to 15, though. And remember, our Lord's patience gives people time to be saved. This is what our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you with the wisdom that God gave him, speaking of these things in all of his letters. Some of his comments are hard to understand, and those who are ignorant and unstable have twisted his letters to mean something quite different, just as they do with other parts of Scripture, and this will result in their destruction.
So it says to me, people do that. Satan does this kind of thing in other Scriptures too, but specifically Paul, it's given a warning about Paul. And it's not Paul's intent. See, it's not that. I think we're misunderstanding. We have to be careful with Paul's words. That's the warning. It doesn't say Paul is Antichrist at all. It doesn't say that. It says just be careful. Go ahead, Bonnie. Who's next?
So Paul was a Pharisee of Pharisees. I mean, he was taught under Gamaliel. It was like the highest of the highest Pharisaical traditions, and everything that Paul knew was so much greater than we can even conceive, because we are not Hebrews born in that time period, and we don't know Torah. I don't care how many, any person in this room, I don't care how much you've been studying it. You're not a Hebrew. You don't understand the Hebraic language. It's not your first language. And it's not the Hebrew of that time period. The Hebrew that's spoken today, even in our translation apps and everything else, is not exactly the same as then. So we are so far removed that for us to impose our Western Christian understanding on the text is so arrogant and prideful. Like, it's disgusting to me. We should not ever think that because our traditions in this century have been going the way they've been going, that they supersede what the Word of God says. And when I read Torah, to my sad, you know, understanding, there's nothing that says that women can't speak. In fact, it encourages women to prophesy. So I'm not a big supporter of women leading a congregation, leading men in a congregation, and as a consistent as the only leader. I think that the times that happened in history were because a man wouldn't step up, and of course those women did wonderful jobs and everything else, but I don't believe that it is our gifting as women to lead. It's so stressful and hard on us. Men do not have the same response to the pressures of leading people that women do.
That's a great
women
point.
Take it much harder to lead people. They're much more soft and tender-hearted. I know there's some women that aren't as tender-hearted, but as a rule, women are. And so I think men are better equipped to. I think women are able to in times that they're needed to step up, and that they can and they should be allowed to. But I don't think it's really God's best, because he designed men and women a certain way. And just speaking on Corinth, so the Church of Corinth, a larger majority of women going into the Corinthian church were temple prostitutes that had come out of that. And so the way they were acting in church, all of these women, and the environment of that society at that time was very questionable. And I think we have to regard Paul's letters as communications that we haven't read all the other letters that may have come before, all the letters from Corinth to Paul.
Exactly.
How do we know that Paul isn't quoting a part of the letter they sent and then rebutting it? There's so many things that we just can't understand. So I love Paul. I love how he expands and helps us understand Torah. I love all of that. However, he is not Yahweh.
There you go.
So I take Paul with a grain of salt. If I can't understand Paul, I go back to Scripture. I'm always going to let Torah actually form my understanding and let Paul spice it up.
I find also going back to Christ's words really helps. Really helps with Paul. Going back to Christ's words for me. Did you want to add something?
No, I just said read the red letters.
Read the red letters helps a lot. First,
Debbie, myself, and then
Debbie,
Doris.
Okay, and then we'll, okay.
Am I on? I'm not on.
It should say either mute
lights
or.
Up.
Yeah, lights up.
So, and I'm like Bernard, I'm always going to be the crier. It always happens, I don't know why. But in my life, I've served in church. I've been nursery director for 8.5 years under a wonderful woman that was a director of children's ministries. And we were in a mainstream type church. We didn't know anything about Torah or anything like that. And I believe that we were pushed down in many, many ways. They built a new building and there was a lot of politics and everything. But I was even asked to leave after 8.5 years because they wanted a man to take my position as nursery director. I can't even imagine, but they did. So they were going to combine both jobs. But however, through this whole process, the biggest thing was living in forgiveness and loving them even though I was hurt. Mm-hmm. And when I listen to all of your pain and suffering, I think about that. And I don't know why people do what they do. I don't understand. And I also don't understand people putting people down and crushing their spirit. I don't understand it. Because Father doesn't do that to us. He loves us so much that He cares for us, and yes, he chastises us when we need it so that we can grow and be the fruit that he wants us to be. So I am so thankful that we have a voice and that we're allowed to talk because I've been on this truth journey since 2012, and I have had a lot of, and thank you, Darla's so good with us.
But Darla doesn't know her gift.
Right. Servant.
Yes. Yes, absolutely it is. But to allow people to speak truth, whatever the subject, whether it's women, men, children, to allow them to speak truth and maybe not be in agreement or not be of the same mind, but to love each other and allow that. In the prophecy thing, it will come because we will be able to see things that Father's doing with others and giving us that opportunity because it's not been. And I thank you all so much for that. And I appreciate you.
You're welcome.
I'm going to piggyback. Sorry, I have to.
You're one. You're married. You're one.
Yeah, she. Debbie was incredible in that role. And the parent, she knew all the children as they went up through. And the parents had so much confidence in her, and they loved her capabilities. And she got railroaded in this situation. It was terrible. And a lot of people talked about leaving, and they assumed that Debbie was going to leave, but she didn't. And she became a witness in that situation about forgiveness. And I saw a lot of people, you know, light bulbs were going on and thinking about their own lives and their particular consequences. So she was a wonderful witness for the Lord, and I was very proud of her through that. So,
amen.
Good job, baby.
Amen. I think Doris.
B.
Oh, you? I'm sorry, I forgot. You had your arm up for like three,
I know,
4 minutes.
Now, so I need prayers for my arm. So next week, Chrissy will come and share about 30 minutes of a study she's done. So one of the things that was interesting that she found was that, understand that Paul in Rome, if women were caught speaking in a church, the Romans would have murdered them and killed them. So Paul might have been doing some things from a perspective of taking care of his flock. It's a very possibility. And it was very interesting. So we did a study with her. Was it a year or so ago? A
couple years or something.
Yeah, it was online with Skip Martin and a bunch. I won't say the guy's name just for instance because he's still an active minister in one of our large church groups, the COGs, I won't mention which one.
But it's not Skip Martin.
It's not Skip Martin. This guy is a paid minister of one of our large COGs, and he was online with us, and he was in absolute 100% agreement, other than the leadership of the female, that we can be allowed to do anything else there is, as long as men step up. So I say this, a lot of the men that complain are the ones that sit in their butts in a chair not doing nothing.
Yeah.
Okay? I'll say that as harsh as I can.
they're the ones that's complaining. So if they don't want to complain, then get off your duff and do something. So that's just the way I see it.
Is duff a Hebrew or Greek word? Duff.
That is Ellenborough English.
Well, one other thing I want to mention is most of you know Diane Garrett.
Hi, Diane.
And she and I actually talked about this. So I'm not talking behind her back or anything. But if you notice, she always wears something on her head. And that is because there are Bible verses where if you're married, that she should do this out of respect for your husband. And so we talked about it. And she said, I'm not absolutely certain that God requires it. But she said, just to be on the safe side, I'm going to do it. Mm-hmm. But one thing I want to emphasize is that not everybody feels the same way on certain issues. And the most important thing is love. And we should not criticize anybody for, you know, and these are not salvational issues either that we're talking about. But I had a conversation when I first started coming here, and I was reading Paul about women having long hair, and it was a shame for them not to have long hair. And there were some women that have short hair, and most of my adult life I've had like shoulder length hair. And I thought, oh, I wonder if that's long enough to please the Lord. And then we all know Betty Simmons. And if you know her, she's got short hair. And I've talked to her about it. And the conclusion I've come up with is this is what Betty said. She said to me, she said, you know what, Doris? I don't think God cares one way or the other.
Yeah. You know, I think the time God cares is when people make things contentious over these. And I agree. See, one thing we teach here is that there's one salvational issue, and that's the sacrificial blood of Christ. So that's the salvational issue. Here's my contention again, is any teaching or forced teaching in many cases that quench the spirit. No, it's not a salvational issue, right? But if you're quenching the spirit of someone, does God like that or not? That should be the question that the elders ought to be asking themselves and really taking a better look at this. And again, I think if you ask the question, well, where is it in Torah? Where are we supposed to get what's right and wrong but from Torah? Paul deals with all sorts of issues. So yeah, there's issues going on there, but he can't add or subtract to it. So we have to find whatever he says or we think he says or what he means, whether we think we mean, yeah, I'm sorry, whatever we think Paul means, we need to back it up by Torah when it comes to specifics like that. Go ahead. I'm not the moderator, really.
Tony and Andrew.
Just want to read these two verses.
Can you go ahead and press your mic one more time?
Okay.
Yeah.
Galatians 3:27-28. Excuse my voice. Allergies. There are, for as many of you have been baptized into Christ and have put on Christ, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. And that's today. That's now. That's not waiting till you get flipped over to a spiritual being. That is now. So we got to quit suppressing and doing the things that we're doing as a church culture. So one thing I wanted to say real quick, then Andrea, and then we got to look at time.
Yeah, we'll probably close it down.
Is that, I don't know if he's still here or not. I'm not going to let him say anything, but if you want to know troublesome, my son is the same age as Chloe, okay, or 1 year older or somewhere around there. Mm-hmm. 1 year, I think. You're 27, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's 28. He just turned 28. If you want to know why he left his church for a long time ago, go pull him in a corner and have a conversation with him. It's because of actions like me, actions like his mother, actions like the elders in the church is the reason two of my sons walked out of here.
That's hypocrisy. Yeah. That's that. Remember, there was two main issues that were talked about at CFN?
Yeah.
That's that side of it, hypocrisy.
Yeah. That's why he walked out of here and just now trying, and the reason he's back now is because of these little ones. Because he loves these little ones. He wants to see his little ones not go and do what the decisions he's made over life. Okay?
He'll tell you, these are his kids.
So, yeah, he's walked out because of leadership. He's walked out because we're so breasted and we got all the knowledge and we do all the things to do. But we've made a mess. You know, the churches have made a mess for a number of times. Andrea and Darla, then we got to think about time.
You know, I've got some Bible verses. Bear with me as I go back and forth here. But, you know, just piggybacking off of what you were saying, Bernard, Paul's great. Paul's got great letters. But they are hard to understand. And the minute we side with Paul, thinking that he contradicts Torah, then we've considered him a false prophet. Amen. Because that's the definition of a false prophet. Yeah, you go against the Torah. And if that's the case, then we are to throw out everything that Paul has said. I don't believe he's a false prophet. I believe we misunderstand.
Amen.
And I think we need to pray for understanding. But what I didn't realize is, after I handed over the mic, we should keep reading. Because also in 2 Peter 3, just after that, the very next verse says, I am warning you ahead of time, dear friends. Be on guard so that you will not be carried away by the errors of these wicked people. Now, this is just where we just said, those that are twisting the words of, it literally flows straight from them. Those who twisted his letters to mean something quite different, just as they do with the other parts of Scripture, and this will result in their destruction. So I am warning you ahead of time, dear friends. Be on guard so that you will not be carried away by the errors of these wicked people and lose your secure footing. Rather, you must grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All glory to him, both now and forever. Amen. We're not to fall into that. You know, like Chloe said, when people put those standards on us and make us question ourselves and everything, we're supposed to pray about it. We're supposed to go back to Torah. We're not supposed to fall into that, because then we do. We begin to teach our children those things, and it's false doctrine, which is exactly what Paul was trying to keep out of the church. But we begin to teach those things, and then they get passed down from generation to generation, and then you have children that leave the church because they don't have a place in the church. We will lose our secure footing if we don't constantly pray about it and go back to Scripture, go back to God's Word, and study it and make sure that it lines up, because if it doesn't line up, we're supposed to throw it out. Now, that being said, some Scripture that I have that I also... you know, we've talked about in the Bible study, we're going back and we started with Genesis and everything. And one of the very first things that the very first thing that he tells man and woman to do when he creates them is he says, go forth and multiply. Okay? Now, were they supposed to fill the earth with other people? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But there's a spiritual side to that. And Yeshua, Jesus, tells us that what that is. His version of go forth and multiply, because we know it can't solely be go have kids or Jesus would have sinned. He didn't have kids. So it can't be that. So what's the spiritual of that? Well, he tells them, go forth and make disciples of all nations. What are we supposed to multiply? We're supposed to multiply God's kingdom. Well, he gave that command to man and woman. Mm-hmm. And it states that very clearly, that he gave it to man and woman. So the women are supposed to, and I love one of the things in the email, and I definitely suggest anybody who wants to read it, it's really good. I suggest reading it. One of the things that was in there was it talks about, I think Satan's laughing right now because we've essentially done his work for him. Mm-hmm. Because we've taken women out of the mission field. And he's like, thanks, guys. That was easy.
It's half.
We've done it. Yeah.
At least.
We have done that. And typically when you think about it, you know, when you look at the school system and stuff, who are usually the teachers? The women. Okay. Who spends the majority of the day with the children, raising them up? The women. So if you take them out and say they have no place in teaching the word of God, well, there goes your youngins, because dad's out in the world working all day. So by the time they get to hear the word of God, they're going to be grown and on their own have to figure it out for themselves. Satan is laughing. We have done this because we have fallen into the same traps that they have set, and we've continued to teach those same ways. Hold on, there was another one.
And speaking of the spirit, what is it, the gift of teaching, it's pretty obvious Andrea has that gift of teaching. So, like, should someone, what does it make sense? Oh, don't use that gift of God. Don't use that gift. Only teach children.
Yeah.
Only teach children. Wait a minute. Teach the children, but not adults. So you want to indoctrinate whatever this evil woman's going to teach them, or you're scared about, or whatever, you know, whatever that issue is.
Yeah.
You're going to teach the kids.
Right.
Why aren't you worried about that then?
Exactly.
I don't see any logic in any of these kind of things at all. Biblical logic or otherwise.
If you want to piggyback, I'll go to my next verse after you piggyback, because we were talking about this last night.
Yeah, so my question is, you know, so the scripture tells us the hierarchy of the family, okay? God is under man, man is under God, female is under man, and man and woman are above the children. At what point is my wife not allowed to teach my son, if Paul's words are correct, our understanding of Paul's words are correct? Once he becomes an adult, she's not allowed to teach him anymore because he's a man. It doesn't make sense to me.
But it was okay
the whole time he's okay.
Now, someone might come back and say, well, that's not in church convocation. And I would say, if two or more are gathered together, you're in church, buddy. if two or more are gathered together. So I don't I don't see much of a difference between holy conversation, convocation with one-on-one and church, except it's really enjoyable when we all come together. And we're not supposed to forsake the assembling of the gathering. But are we not having church when we have a communication about God or anything, one-on-one or teaching or spreading the gospel? Is not spreading the gospel teaching? How could you not? How could you spread the gospel without teaching something? I would love for someone to explain that to me because I don't understand that. Yeah. Anyway, I know
and Bonnie gave me another one. In Titus 2, verse 3, it says, the older women likewise are to be set apart in behavior, not slanderers, not given to much wine, teachers of what is good. We are to train the next generation. We are, like, that's what we're designed to do, which is why I believe that we kind of fall into that category of teachers. It's inherent in most of us. I mean, not all women desire to be mothers. Not all women desire to be teachers. But the majority of us grow up from a very young age desiring to nurture and to teach. And I think that's what we're designed to do. And that's an awesome verse to show you that. Also, what Bonnie was saying earlier, where she was talking about in certain situations in the Torah, you know, my husband just talked about hierarchy and how if your house is in order, okay, and there's your home house, and then there's your house, okay, this is his house, and we have to make sure his house is in order because he's not a god of chaos,
right?
Okay, and that's what Paul was talking about. They were getting ready to disrupt what little church had finally started, and he was like, y'all are going to ruin this before it even gets off the ground. We can't have this. Well, if our house is in order and we are doing things correctly and I am under my husband's authority and we've talked this out, then things are going to work out right. But if my husband decides he wants to abdicate his role of head, I still have to teach the kids. The bills still have to get paid. Somebody's got to go to work. So what happens? The woman has no choice but to rise up to save those that, you know, the children and things like that. She has no choice. And a biblical example of that is Exodus 4, verse 25. But Moses' wife Zipporah took a flint knife and circumcised her son. She touched his feet with the foreskin and said, now you are a bridegroom of blood to me. There's a whole thing behind that. But the bottom line is, the verse before it says, God met Moses on the road and was going to kill him because he hadn't done what he was supposed to do. He abdicated his role. It's Moses! Yeah, he abdicated his role as the head. Zipporah said, this is where I become the helpmeet. This is where I rise up. And then she immediately took her place back in submission once he was like, I should have done that. You know what I mean? It wasn't a battle for authority. She rose up when she was supposed to. She stepped in and did what he needed as his helpmeet. And then she backed right back up into her spot. We don't hear that Zipporah took over and led them out of Egypt under God's command. She stepped back into her role. But she was there when he needed him to be. And that is how the order goes. And you know, you were talking about what your gift is, and I think we all know what your gift is, but I think it's a servant. And it made me look up where we saw that the woman was a deacon. Mm-hmm. And the word there for deacon is actually servant. Servant. A servant of a king. And it also says that oftentimes they will have the right, and they are to feed the poor. That's one of their jobs. Hold on. Well, we know that she feeds all of us. But they are to feed the poor, and they are to use the funds of the congregation to take care of the needy within there. Well, guys, we all better be doing that. And if we're not, then we need to self-reflect. So we all, you can't sit here and say that only the men are supposed to go out and take care of the poor, and only the men are supposed to be servants of the Most High God and wash each other's feet and do those things. He calls us all to. So we have to all be doing that.
You conveyed that so well. You should think about being a teacher.
Maybe.
Darla, and then I think that'll be it, and we'll close. After Darla, we'll close.
I don't want to sing. I will say, though, I can't remember exactly where the scripture's at, and I can't get to my stuff because it's kind of like blocked here. But it tells us not to lean on our own understanding, to trust in the Lord with all our heart, to seek his ways, and we are supposed to always be striving to dig for the truth, you get what I'm trying to say, you know.
We're picking up what you're laying down.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and we're like, there was an elder woman in the church, she had made a comment, and I won't say to who, that she did not see where the women in the church spirits were being quenched, you know, by not being able to do whatever. And I'm thinking, you know, obviously your eyes are closed. But I had to understand her point of view. She's coming from a different era, genre, and, you know, way back when, when men did dominate in the church, and a lot of times they still do. But I'm going to say this to the men in the church. You guys need to be approachable. You know, if a woman don't understand an issue, or if your wife, your daughter, you know, anyone in the church, they should be able to approach you about any issue whatsoever without fear of condemnation.
And or belittlement.
Honest,
or
you're all not approachable.
Or belittlement, like, you know.
Yes, yes, don't treat her like
she's stupid.
So you go,
what, you don't know that? You know, that
kind
of thing.
But I'm saying be approachable. You know, be willing, like you're talking about, hear the matter first. Don't be like, how do you not know this? Or how do you not? That's not how you reply back to anyone.
Amen.
Because to me, that induces chaos and resentment. Like, well, what's the point?
I'm sure Jesus didn't do that
anyway. Yes.
Amen.
But it comes a point, and why I say I do not believe that a woman should be in a leadership role up there is because it's got to be a balance. You know, men look at things different than women do. Like, you know, women are going to be more emotional, you know, be like, oh, gosh, you know, I feel so sorry for you. Instead of some of them, you know, I've been told I'm not approachable. At times I can be, and it may be that I'm a little bit hard-hearted to a degree, but not all the way, but we got to be more approachable. And it's just...
We're all works in progress, you know.
But that's what I'm saying. It's got to be... What is it? Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. You know, Christ loved even his enemy. He asked God on the cross to forgive them because they didn't know what they were doing. Yeah. You know, and I think I feel sorry more for Judas Iscariot. And you might all think I'm crazy, but there had to be that person to do that in order for the Father's plan to be done.
And, you know the interesting thing about it is, and this was brought up back. Yeah. This is brought up on that note about Judas really quickly. Something was said recently in an interview in The Chosen. There's been a lot of stuff going on in the story of The Chosen and you know, this production, okay? And there's a lot of things they're getting into that are very interesting. That's all I got to say. But when it comes to Judas, one of the statements that I think it was Dallas said, maybe, and he's the main guy behind the whole thing, but one of the statements that was said was, you know, Christ might have forgiven Judas if he didn't just hang himself. I never thought of that before. But think about it for a minute. Peter was told, you're going to deny me three times before the cock... Well, wait, I'm sorry. You're going to deny me three times before the cock crows. That's what it was. And that happened, but what happened later? Okay, Christ could have not forgiven him, right? But what did he do? He forgave him. He asked him even three times, do you love me, Peter? And I think Peter, I mean, what kind of... Wow, imagine what he felt in his heart. At that point, you know, we just kind of read over that. But what was really going on there in his heart, right? So what? Just think about it. If Judas didn't hang himself and he went to Christ and he said, I'm an idiot or whatever, you know, I'm so sorry. I know you're not going to let me in your kingdom or whatever you'd say. Don't you think Christ would have forgiven him if he repented? You know, he didn't have the opportunity. I believe he's going to have that opportunity. But whatever. But the point is that we don't know. But I... From what I understand about Christ's heart, I just have that feeling anyway. But anyway, I just thought of that because it was brought up. But anyway, let's obviously, and there's many, many scriptures we got to look at. We have to look at the scriptures that are brought up. There's other ones that are brought up. There's other things to talk about. So maybe we should go two more weeks. We'll see how it goes. I don't know. We got a lot of stuff to still cover, you know. But anyway, you know, the point is let's go through these studies for ourselves. We should have be ready to give answer for anything, right? At least try. And when you don't know, see something, I don't know. Whatever the case is, you know. But anyway, let's close. There was a lot of great comments, and we'll continue next week. And everybody, look into it a little bit more. Look into that link. I'll send it out as a reminder this week. But look into that link about that whole challenge about that particular scripture. It's worth looking at for sure.